this big black girl was saying, I'm in love with myself. I love my skin. I was like, why is this such a shocker to y'all?
We all want to look our best, but what is it that makes someone beautiful? Could an ancient math equation be the answer? Or is the truth just a little bit more complicated than that? By now, you might have heard the news that Bella Hadid is the most beautiful woman in the world, according to science. That's it, the rest of us can just give up now and call it a day. But seriously, what is science, and does it really hold up to any kind of serious scrutiny? This list of the most beautiful women in the world is made up of women who are traditionally considered beautiful. After Bella Hadid, there's Beyoncé, Amber Heard, Ariana Grande, and Taylor Swift. Then there's legendary fashion model Kate Moss, Scarlett Johansson, Natalie Portman, Katy Perry, and Cara Delevingne. Although they're all highly ranked, these women all look different from one another. So on what basis are they the most beautiful? If you ask 10 people to reorder these celebs from most to least beautiful, you'd probably get 10 different lists. Well, first, let's consider the source, Dr. Julian De Silva, who runs the Center for Advanced Facial Cosmetic and Plastic Surgery in London. Is it possible that a plastic surgeon might have a little bit of an incentive to promote a certain beauty ideal? Dr. De Silva claims these calculations are based on something called the golden ratio. This equation is used to analyze proportions, and many people believe it is the secret to getting the most aesthetically pleasing appearance possible. And it does allow us to break down our faces to a crazy level. According to Dr. Kendra Schmid, on a perfect face, the length of an ear is equal to the length of a nose, and the ideal eye width is equal to the distance between the eyes. But before you take a ruler to your own face, we have something for you to consider. Sure, lots of lovely things like flowers and seashells match up to the golden ratio, but you know who doesn't? Legendary actress Angelina Jolie, who is widely considered to be one of the most beautiful women in the world, if not the most beautiful. And people think that without even measuring her eyeballs. The truth is that beauty isn't really something you can quantify. Mathematician John Allen Paulos claims there's no evidence that the golden ratio has any bearing on what we find attractive. In fact, many classic examples of the golden ratio in nature, like the shell of a nautilus, don't always fit precisely into the golden rectangle. Just look at the stunning Lupita Nyong’o. She was People magazine's most beautiful woman of 2014, yet she was teased relentlessly about her appearance when she was growing up. Looking back on women who were considered beautiful throughout history, it's clear there is much more at play here than a simple formula. In many ways, what we consider beautiful is shaped by society. Just look at how social media has changed what we find attractive. Kylie Jenner is the queen of Instagram, but even she admits that her makeup looks often only work online and don't always translate to the real world. The makeup of the 2010s is practically defined by the Instagram look. We're talking tons of contour, thin and perfectly coiffed eyebrows, and don't skimp on the highlights. But even this newer trend isn't really new. Before Kim Kardashian was a fashion icon, people used makeup like this mostly for the stage, since it was bold enough to translate well for the audience. It seems like just yesterday James Charles was teaching us how to contour, but some people believe the classic influencer look is already on the way out. This is just a testament to how far beauty has come and how quickly it can change. Over 20,000 years ago, curves were attributed to fertility and thus considered highly desirable. Just take a look at the Venus of Willendorf, one of the oldest works of art which exemplifies these ideals. And take a look at Phryne from ancient Greece, who was born in 371 BC and inspired Apelles' famous painting Aphrodite Rising from the Sea. Even though she's not quite as curvaceous as the Venus of Willendorf, her elongated body is still plenty curvy. And this is something we still find attractive today. Just look at gorgeous actress Margot Robbie rising from the sea in her bikini, or a star like Jessica Biel. But there were definitely times in history when a more exaggerated form than this was in vogue. There's a reason why a lot of women throughout history spent time stuffing themselves into corsets and various types of shapewear. It was all about tucking in the waist and getting the perfect exaggerated hourglass figure. Tight bodices and big petticoats were a thing through much of human history from the Middle Ages through the Elizabethan and Victorian eras. Even modern celebrities have been known to use shapewear to push their bodies into perfect proportions.
Okay, so Anna, if I don't sit down for dinner, now you know why.
Beyoncé is no stranger to corsets, and Kim Kardashian admits she often wears multiple pairs of Spanx at the same time. But in the 1920s, things changed, and all of a sudden, thin was in. During this time, most of the steel that had gone into corsets was going towards the First World War, and women were experiencing unprecedented freedom, and not just from corsets. Women could vote, play sports, and go to work. They still wore shapewear, but it was lighter, cheaper, and less unforgiving. The flapper style was in, and many classic actresses embodied this kind of flapper aesthetic. Think about Josephine Baker, Greta Garbo, Betty Davis, and Clara Bow. Between 1901 and 1925, the bust-to-hip ratios featured in magazines plummeted 60%. An unfortunate side effect of this was that eating disorders became more and more common around this time. But by the time the late 1940s rolled around, the bust-to-hip ratio had jumped back up by a third, which was reflected in celebrities like Marilyn Monroe. Many people claim she was a plus-size celebrity, but that's actually not true, at least by today's standards. Clothing sizes were different back then, and although her weight fluctuated over the course of her career by today's standards, she would be somewhere around a size 6 or 8. Still, curves were definitely back in style, and stars like Jane Mansfield, Grace Kelly, and Ruby Dee were beauty goals for many women. The hourglass was back, and even women's facial features were fuller figured. Big eyebrows with prominent arches were all the rage. For a modern reference, think about Dita Von Teese. But things changed a great deal in the 1960s and 70s. The women's rights movement was revived, the birth control pill was approved by the FDA, and women enjoyed freedom they weren't able to achieve before. But as their freedom grew, their waist-to-hip ratios plummeted. Thin was in again, and models like Twiggy exemplified the beauty standards of the time. Other slender stars at the time were Tina Louise, Elizabeth Montgomery, and Jane Fonda. But this wasn't just a style rewind. Instead of relying solely on shapewear, there was a huge push towards using diet and exercise to maintain a healthy figure. In the 1980s, people were turning in their girdles for the treadmill, and strong, svelte stars like Linda Carter, Kathleen Turner, and Michelle Pfeiffer were making headlines. But in the 1990s, women were expected to be even thinner, and it didn't matter how they did it. The first Victoria's Secret fashion show took place in 1995, and super thin models like Kate Moss, Christy Turlington, and Naomi Campbell were all the rage. Even Oprah was desperate to lose weight by the tail end of the 1980s, resorting to a liquid diet to shed 67 pounds. Eating disorders hit an all-time high as people went to extremes in order to get thin. Out of all mental disorders, anorexia has the highest mortality rate, which means this was a serious problem. And on the other end of the spectrum, the obesity epidemic kicked off around this time as people began living more sedentary lives and eating less healthy foods. Thankfully, there does seem to be a light at the end of the tunnel. Back when Destiny's Child first formed, no designers wanted to provide clothes for four black, country, curvy girls, according to Beyoncé. Yes, the same Beyoncé who was supposedly one of the most attractive women in the world, according to the Golden Ratio. Since the gals couldn't afford high-end couture, Beyoncé's mom had to step in and make outfits for them. We have a feeling all the designers who missed their chance to dress Beyoncé are probably kicking themselves right about now. Now, we have stars like Lizzo, who aren't afraid to call out designers who refuse to accommodate larger sizes. Singer Bebe Rexha is a size 8 and called out the designers who refused to dress her for the Grammys because of her body.
A lot of them do not want to dress me because I'm too big.
Victoria's Secret had been criticized for years for their lack of body size diversity, and it seems like people had enough. In 2018, their chief marketing officer, Ed Razek, spoke out in defense of their hiring practices and claimed plus size or trans models didn't fit in with their fantasy image. The public backlash was huge, and since then, Ed Razek has stepped down, and Victoria's Secret hired their first trans model, Valentina Sampao, and plus size model, Ali Tate Cutler. It seems like the definition of what makes someone beautiful is more broad than ever. Of course, many fashion and makeup trends come and go, but we're really hoping the body positivity trend is here to stay. And of course, there are many current celebrities who look a lot like celebrities who were famous at various points in history. Just take a look at Audrey Hepburn and Lily Collins, or former supermodel Carla Bruni and current supermodel and supposed most beautiful woman in the world, Bella Hadid. There's also Helen Mirren and Jennifer Lawrence and Donna Summer and Kelly Rowland. Sometimes it can even be difficult to tell Tammy Terrell and Taraji P. Henson apart. And don't get us started on the sassy similarities between Sophia Loren and Sofia Vergara. Not only is what we consider beautiful always changing, but so is the importance of being considered beautiful in the first place. Cleopatra was famous for many things and was well known as being a great beauty, except for the fact that she didn't look anything like most people imagined. When coins were discovered bearing her face, people were stunned that she didn't look like Elizabeth Taylor in the 1963 Cleopatra movie. It turns out that many accounts of her looks were exaggerated to try to detract from the fact that she was a clever and successful woman who didn't rely solely on her looks. Maybe there will be a time when we don't correlate intelligence and skill with beauty or lack thereof. One of these women has a psychology degree from Harvard, while the other one dropped out of high school. Can you guess which one is which by looking at them? Of course not. But just for the record, Natalie Portman has the degree while Gisele Bündchen dropped out in order to pursue her modeling career. Our willingness to shimmy into shapewear may change through history, but what makes people beautiful definitely can't be dumbed down to a simple ratio. There have always been many ways to be attractive, and people seem to be realizing that now more than ever. Now that's a trend we can definitely get behind. What do you think about the way beauty has evolved over the years? Are there any trends you hope make a comeback, or are you happy with the way things are going? Tell us what you think in the comments and then click subscribe for more videos from The Taco. Bye for now.